Hello everyone. So now as we have revised the two chapters of the chemistry as well as the one chapter of the physics, and that was the chapter number 10, light, reflection and refraction. Today we are going to revise the another chapter, that is chapter number 11, the human eye and the colorful world. The human eye and the colorful world. So I hope students now you are clear with the reflection, refraction, dispersion and the spectrum as well. Okay. You know that when a light is incident on a smooth plane surface, it reflects back, and that phenomena is known as reflection. In the same way, whenever a light passes from a transparent surface, it bends towards the normal. When a light travels from a transparent substance, it travels through the normal and it bends a little, and that phenomena is known as refraction. It is known as refraction. Various types of lens we use in our day-to-day life. Even for clear vision, we also use some types of spectacles to correct the defects of our vision. Which are they? Let's see that. You have studied the previous chapter about the refraction of light by lenses. You also studied the nature, position, and relative size of images formed by lenses. How can these ideas help us in study of the human eye? The human eye uses lights and enable us to see objects around us. It has a lens in its structure. What is the function of the lens in a human eye? How do the lens used in a spectacles correct defects of the vision? We have learned in previous chapter about light and some of its properties. In this chapter, we shall use these ideas to study some of the optical phenomena in nature. We shall also discuss about the rainbow formation, the splitting of white light and the blue color of the sky. Okay, but first we will start with the human eye. What is human eye? How does it work? Let us see that. The human eye is one of the most valuable and sensitive organ. Please note that students, human eye is one of the most valuable and sensitive organs. It enables us to see the wonderful world and the colors around us. On closing the eyes, we can identify objects to some extent by their smell, taste, sound they make, or by touch. See, as you all know from the previous chapter of 7th chapter we did of the biology, these all are the receptory organs. Fine, they can sense smell, taste, sound, or we can also touch the objects. It is, however, impossible to identify the colors while closing the eyes. Thus, of all the sense organs, the human eye is the most significant one, as it enables us to see the beautiful, colorful world around us. Fine students, I hope you are clear that human eye is said to be the most significant one, as it enables us to see the beautiful, colorful world around us. Visionary reception. Okay, the things through which we can see anything is said to be the strongest receptory organ among the body. Fine. I hope students you are clear with this. The human eye is like a camera. Its lens system forms an image on a light sensitive screen called retina. Please note this student, that the human eye is like a camera. The human eye is like a camera. Its lens system forms an image on the light sensitive screen called retina. Fine. So where the screen, the image of the screen is formed, it is formed on the retina, which is light sensitive. That means it can sense the light. Then light enters the eye through a thin membrane called cornea. Light enters the eye through a thin membrane called cornea. It forms the transparent bulge on the front of the surface of the eyeball. It forms the transparent bulge on the front surface of the eyeball. The eyeball is approximately spherical in shape with a diameter of about 2.3 cm. Please note this students, that the eyeball is approximately spherical in shape with a diameter of about 2.3 cm. Most of the refraction for the light rays entering the eye occurs at the outer surface of the cornea. Most of the refraction of the light rays entering the eye occurs at the outer surface of the cornea. Fine, students. Crystalline lens merely provides the finer adjustment of the focal length required to focus objects at different distances on the retina. Okay, so crystalline lenses are said to be the autofocus, which are responsible for the diversion and the conversions of the retina. That means it can also make the eyeball thin as well as the eyeball thick. Fine, so crystalline lens merely provides the finer adjustment of the focal length required to focus objects at different distances on the retina. We find a structure called iris behind the cornea. Iris is a dark muscular diaphragm that controls the size of the pupil. Okay, please note that iris is a dark muscular diaphragm that is controlling the size of the pupil. Where else what pupil do? That pupil regulates the control and the amount of light entering the eye. The pupil regulates and controls the amount of light entering the eye. Remember one thing, the eye lens forms always an inverted real image of the object on the retina. The retina is a delicate membrane having enormous number of light sensitive cells. Please note this, students, that retina is a delicate membrane having enormous number of light sensitive cells. These light sensitive cells get activated upon illumination and generates electric signal. These signals are sent to the brain via optic nerves. Please note this, students, that the signals to the brain are sent via optic nerves. Fine, the central nervous system that we studied in 7th chapter. The brain interprets these signals and finally process the information so that we perceive objects as they are. Okay. I hope, students, now you are clear with the human eye. See, they have given us the basic diagram of the human eye and how it is working. Okay. So at the exit in between, it is the crystalline lens that is actually measuring the amount of light entering into our eyes. Then comes the aqueous humor. The aqueous humor is a liquid-filled crystal which is responsible for the elasticity of the human eye. Then comes pupil. Pupil is the exact central part of the eye that is controlling the amount of light entering into our eye. Then there is an iris. As you all know that iris is a dark muscular diaphragm that is controlling the size of the pupil. Fine. And then comes the vitreous humor. It is also a liquid filled crystal which are responsible for the elasticity of it. Then the retina. Retina is sensing the light. As we all know that retina is a light sensitive screen. The conversion and the divergence is done by the ciliary muscles. So ciliary muscles are usually used for the focal adjustment. And then finally comes the optic nerves, through which the sensory brain electric signals are sent to the optical nerves. Okay. I hope, students, you are clear with this. Okay. See how the eye works, that we will learn today in Do You Know. Damage to or a malfunction of any part of the visual system can lead to the significant loss of visual functioning. Damage to or a malfunctioning of any part of the visual system can lead to the significant loss of the visual functioning. If any of the structures involved in the transmission of light, like the cornea, pupil, eye lens, aqueous humor, and vitreous humor, or those responsible for the conversion of light to electrical impulse. Fine. Like the retina or even the optic nerves that transmit these impulses to the brain is damaged. It will result in the visual impairment. Fine, students, so it can also lead to the complete loss of the eyes or the visual loss of the eyes. You might have experienced that you are not able to see objects clearly for some time when you enter from the bright light to a room with a dim light. After some time, however, you may be able to see the things that are in the dim light room. The pupil of an eye acts like a variable aperture whose size can be varied with the help of the iris. As we have seen that the pupil of the eye can act like a variable whose size can be varied with the help of the iris. When the light is very bright, the iris contracts the pupil to allow less light to enter the eye. Fine, as you all know that whenever we are keeping on the light instantly in the dark, our eyes gets closed by itself. It is the same form. Okay. However, in a dim light, the iris expands the pupil to allow more light to enter the eye. Thus, the pupil opens completely through the relaxation of the iris. Fine, students, I hope you are clear with this. If you are having any doubts, then you please let me know. So, we will move towards the next topic, and that is known as power of accommodation. Power of accommodation. The eye lens is composed of a fibrous jelly-like material. Wait, the eye lens is composed of a fibrous jelly-like material. Its curvature can be modified to some extent by the ciliary muscles. The change in the curvature of the eye lens can thus change its focal length also. When the muscles are relaxed, they become thin. Please note this, if it can be also asked in the MCQs or like that. Okay, that the focal length increases. When the muscles are relaxed, the eye lens becomes thin. Thus, its focal length increases. This enables us to see the distant objects clearly. But whenever you are looking at an object closer to the eye, the ciliary muscles contract. Okay, so there is an contraction and expansion. So if you want to see the clear thing, closer things nearly clearly, you need to contract your eyes. As well as if you want to see far away things clearly, you need to expand your eye lens. Okay. This increases the curvature of the eye lens. The eye lens then become thicker. Consequently, the focal length of the eye lens decreases. This enables us to see the nearby objects clearly. The ability of an eye lens to adjust its focal length is called accommodation. Students, you please note this, that the ability of an eye lens to adjust its focal length is called accommodation. I repeat, fine. That how much your eye lens can adjust its focal length, that is your accommodation of an eye. It depends on the individual. Okay, somebody have a different focal length or an accommodation, while the individual another the NB have a different form. The focal length of the eye lens cannot be decreased below a certain limit. Try to read a printed page by holding it very close to your eyes. You may see the image being blurred or feel strain in the eyes. To see an object comfortably and distinctly, you must hold it at about 25 cm from the eye. So students, you need to know that the minimum distance at which objects can be seen most distinctly without strain is called least distance of the distinct vision. Okay. The minimum distance at which objects can be seen most distinctly without strain is called least distance at distinct vision. It is also called the near point of the eye. For a young adult with a normal vision, the near point is about 25 centimeters. The near point is about 25 centimeters. The farthest point up to which the eye can see objects clearly is called the far point of the eye. It is infinity for a normal eye. It is infinity for a normal eye. You may note here a normal eye can see objects clearly, that is between of 25 centimeter and infinity. Please note this, students, that you may have known a normal eye can see objects clearly that are between 25 centimeters and infinity. Okay. So now we will be starting the defects of vision. Let us see that in details. The crystalline lens of the people at old age becomes milky and cloudy. This condition is called cataract. Okay, I repeat. The crystalline lens of the people at old age becomes milky and cloudy. This condition is also called cataract. This causes partial or complete loss of vision. It is possible to restore vision through a cataract surgery. Fine, students, I hope you are clear with this. See, there are several advantages of having having two eyes instead of one. So this paragraph is, why do we have two eyes for vision and not just one? Let us see that. There are several advantages of having our two eyes instead of one. It gives a wider field of view. A human being has an horizontal field of view of about 150 degrees with one eye and of about 180 degrees with two eyes. The ability to detect faint objects is of course enhanced with two detectors instead of one. Some animals, usually prey animals, have their two eyes positioned on opposite sides of their head to give the widest view possible. But our two eyes are positioned in front, the front of our head, and it thus reduces our field of view in our favor of what is called stereopsis. Shut one eye and the world looks flat, two-dimensional. Keep both the eyes open and the world looks three dimensions of depth. Because our eyes are separated by a few centimeters, each eye sees a slightly different image. Our brain combines the two images into one, using the extra information to tell us how close or far the things are. Fine, students, I hope you are clear with this. If you are having any doubts, then you please let me know. So now we are going to start the three main topics of the defects of vision and the correction of eye. Sometimes the eye may gradually lose its power of accommodation. In such a condition, the person cannot see the objects clearly and comfortably. This vision becomes blurred due to refractive defects of the eye. There are main three common refractive defects of vision: myopia or nearsightedness, hypermetropia or farsightedness. I repeat, students, myopia or nearsightedness, hypermetropia or farsightedness, and the presbyopia. Let us start with a myopia. Myopia is also known as nearsightedness. A person with myopic eye can see nearby objects clearly, but cannot see distant objects clearly. Students, I hope you are clear with this. Myopia is known as nearsightedness. Nearsightedness means in this defects or vision of vision, you can see nearby objects clearly, but you cannot see distant objects clearly. A person with this defect has the far point near than the infinity. A person with this defect has the far point near than the infinity. See, on the figure you can see the A is the normal form, but if it is a myopic eye, the far point is more nearer than the infinity. Okay. Such a person may see clearly up to a distance of few meters. In a myopic eye, the image of the distant object is formed in the front of the retina and not at the retina. Find what happens, students. In a myopic eye, the image is formed on the front of the retina and not at the retina. At the retina, it won't form. So we need to add some correction for this myopic eye. Let us see that. See, this defect may arise due to the two forms. Due to the excessive curvature of the eye lens. Due to excessive curvature of eye lens stands for what? That the eye lens gets too much curved. Okay. Or the next thing is elongation of the eyeballs. Due to the digitization, the eyeball has increased in size. So there are two main forms due to this type of defect arises. And they are excessive curvature of eye lens and the elongation of the eyeballs. This defect can be corrected by using a concave lens of the suitable power. A concave lens of suitable power will bring the image back onto the retina and thus the defect is corrected. So students, you need to know that for a myopic eye, the correction is the concave lens. For the myopic eye, the correction is the concave lens. Okay students, I hope you are clear with this. So now, the next topic, we'll start with hypermetropia. Hypermetropia is also known as farsightedness. So, a person with hypermetropia can see the distant objects clearly, but cannot see nearby objects clearly. Fine? So, what happens? See, in farsightedness, as the name suggests, you can see the clearly the distant objects, but cannot see the nearby objects clearly. So, a hypermetropia is also known for a farsightedness. A person with hypermetropia can see objects clearly, distant objects clearly, but cannot see nearby objects clearly. The near point for the person is farther away from the normal point. Such a person has to keep a reading material beyond 25 cm from the eye for comfortable reading. This is because the light rays from a close by objects are focused at a point behind the retina. So students, there the image was formed before retina, and over here in a farsightedness, the point is formed after retina. Please note this, students. Such a person has to keep a reading material beyond 25 cm from the eye for a comfortable reading. This is because the light rays from a close by object focused at a point behind the retina. And this defect arises due to two main forms. The focal length of the eye lens is too long. Or the eyeball has become too small. Fine, there we have seen that the eyeball has become too big, but over here what happens? The eyeball has become too small and the focal length of the eye lens is too long. This defect can be corrected by using a convex lens of an appropriate power. Eyeglasses with a converging lenses provide the additional focusing power required for forming the image on the retina. Fine students, I hope you are clear with this. If you are having any doubts, then please let me know. See, for the correction you need to have a convex lens. So this was the hypermetropia. Let us move on to the next topic, and that is presbyopia. The power of accommodation of an eye usually decreases with aging, of course. See, if our age increases, the accommodation, that is the focal adjustment of the human eye, also decreases. Okay, and so it is written over here. that the power of accommodation of the eye usually decreases with aging. For most people, the near point of the eyes gradually recedes away. That means you cannot see the nearby objects clearly. They find it difficult to see the nearby objects comfortably and distinctly without corrective eyeglasses. They find it difficult to see nearby objects comfortably and distinctly without corrective eyeglasses. And thus, this defect is called presbyopia. This defect is called presbyopia. As it is, you cannot see even far objects clearly as well as nearby objects clearly, and so it is known as presbyopia. It arises due to the gradual weakening of the ciliary muscles and diminishing flexibility of the eye lens. I repeat, it arises due to the gradually weakening of the ciliary muscles and diminishing flexibility of the eye lens. Person may suffer from both myopia and hypermetropia. Such people often require bifocal lenses. A common type of bifocal lens consists of both a convex lens and a concave lens. I repeat, a common type of bifocal lens consists of both concave and a convex lens. The upper portion consists of concave lens, facilitates the distant vision, and the lower part is a convex lens, facilitates the near vision. These days it is possible to correct the refractive defects by a concave lens, contact lens, or through the surgical interventions. Fine students, I hope you are clear with the defects of vision. From tomorrow we will continue towards the next topic. Thank you.